Good morning and welcome to this, the third meeting of the Standards, Procedures and Public Appointments Committee. Today we are going to listen to evidence in relation to the election. But before that, we have a decision to be made, which is whether or not this committee agrees to take Section 3, which will be the committee's consideration of the evidence that we're going to hear today, in private. Are the committee in agreement with that? Excellent. Thank you. Then we can move on. And I can welcome Andy O'Neill and Phil Thompson from the Electoral Commission Scotland, Louise Edwards, Malcolm Burr and Chris Highcock. Welcome and thank you for coming along this morning, both in person and online. We have quite a tight session today, so when we get to the committee members' questions, we're not expecting answers from everybody, but perhaps answers from those who are best able to contribute to the evidence. But before we start, can I invite Andy, and then I'll invite you, Malcolm, to give a short opening statement. Over to you, Andy.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. Thanks for inviting the Commission to give evidence today on the Scottish Parliament elections, which took place on the 6th of May, and our recent report on the administration of it. As Convener said, I'm Andy O'Neill. I'm head of the Electoral Commission in Scotland. I'm joined with colleagues on virtually on the internet, Louise Edwards, who is our Director of Regulation, and Phil Thompson, who's our head of research. I think in kind of summing up the election, I think it's fair to say that in late 2020, against the shifting backdrop of the global pandemic, it wasn't clear at times if the election would take place, or if it did, in what form. I think it's testament to the hard work of everyone in the electoral community that not only did it take place, but that it was well run and commanded the confidence of the voter. The electoral community, and by that I mean government, political parties, administrators, alongside ourselves and the Commission, worked collaboratively over a long period to agree and put in place changes for this election, which helped support and reassure voters. Our post-poll surveys found that 95% of voters were satisfied with the process of voting at the election, and 94% said they used the preferred method of voting. The majority of candidates, 88%, said that the election had been well run. Voters and candidates did not appear deterred from participating at the poll, and we saw the highest ever turnout at 63.5%, and the largest number of constituency candidates at 357 since 2003. I think in general, we, from our survey, find yet again that voter confidence in the elections remains high, with 85% of voters saying it was well run. However, the experience of these polls has once again to the Commission highlighted concerns about resilience and capacity of electoral administration services. No doubt we will explore some of these issues in the session. Whilst campaigners had confidence that the election was well run, many felt restricted in their ability to campaign as a result of the pandemic. Nonetheless, campaigners were able to communicate with voters during the campaign, and voters reported that they had enough information to decide who to vote for. Campaigners also largely understood and complied with the new rules with regards to digital imprints. I think the context of the pandemic and its twists and turns meant that those running the election faced particular challenges securing polling station venues and finding and training staff to work on polling day. There was also a reliance on a small marketplace of expert suppliers for specialist election services, including ballot printing, and this creates risk and continues to do so. We have repeatedly highlighted concerns about the resilience and capacity of electoral administration services in Scotland and wider across the UK. And this creates challenges for the future, which I think we all have to address. In addition, further legislative changes are potentially in the pipeline, and it's crucial that these services and changes are properly resourced and funded in the future so that voters can continue to receive the support they need to register and vote. We should also say that there were some positives which came out of the election in a pandemic context, and these legacies which will likely be taken forward as we move forward to the Scottish Council elections on 5th May 2022. We intend to continue working in partnership with the Electoral Management Board for Scotland, governments and others in the electoral community to ensure that those elections on 5th May are successful. Thank you.
Thank you. Over to you, Malcolm.
Thank you very much, Chair. Good morning, and to members of the committee. My colleague Chris Hycock, the Secretary to the Board, and I are very pleased to have the opportunity to answer your questions and provide you with evidence as you reflect on the delivery of this remarkable event. I won't reiterate what Andy has said about the circumstances of that election. We all know it was the most extraordinary public health situation any of us has encountered. So the election itself was a challenging event, not just to run but to plan for, because there was considerable anxiety in the electoral and wider community at the very time of planning the election as to whether it could safely go ahead. And I'll come on to, I think, some of the mitigating factors which we put in place to ensure that it did. I'm very pleased to see the excellent feedback from candidates, agents, media, voters that the election was well delivered in these circumstances, and also from public health colleagues who confirmed that it appears that with the measures we were able to implement, polling and count activities did not lead to any further spread of the virus. You have before you the report from the Commission, and that sets out the statistics, and they're worth noting. The highest ever registered electorate in Scotland, the largest number of postal voters that the system has ever supported in any democratic event. And with an above average turnout of 63%, it was very encouraging, to say the least, that democracy was able to be supported and to be delivered even in the midst of the pandemic. Now, that success was possible only due to the immense effort of the electoral community, with the backing and support of our many stakeholders. It's always invidious to single out names, but I will mention local authorities, Police Scotland, Public Health Scotland particularly. This was the first Scottish Parliament election for which I have had oversight as convener of the Electoral Management Board as a result of the Elections Reform Act of 2020, and I'm very pleased and indeed encouraged that the EMB was able to provide leadership, consistency and a robust structure to support the electoral community in delivering these polls. I'll cover very briefly, if I may, just four points of detail. First is an obvious one. The impact of COVID was total as regards the electoral process, registration, nominations, postal voting, polling, the count, all revised, and all revised quite significantly in the light of public health guidance. We all know polling places looked very different. They had screens, they had one-way systems, they had extra staff, they had even individual pencils. Some of these elements were addressed through guidance, others, the main one being the need to limit the number of voters per station, were made the subject of legal direction. Second point I would make is that the professional advice from Public Health Scotland was very valuable. We made early contact with Public Health Scotland and then with individual directors of public health, so that the supplementary guidance we provided was current, obviously, and was tailored to the electoral process. And that partnership was a very good one. And it was reassuring, I think, to everyone in the electoral community. My third point is simply the corporate responsibility from returning officers and electoral registration officers. There were concerns about the wisdom of conducting the elections at all in the early part of 2020, but I think the process has shown that with clear guidance, with explicit directions, with expert advice and a large element of personal support, there was reassurance to allow returning officers to conclude that the elections would be safely run in this regulated environment. And the work in the place of the EMB was a key element of that assurance. Finally, the cooperation of the political process and Scottish Government. We engaged with Scottish Government from March 2020 to ensure that the legal framework for the elections would reflect the specific circumstances of COVID. The result of that, of course, was the General Election Coronavirus Act 2021, drafted heavily based on the advice of the EMB, and that affected a number of changes to the regulations necessary to mitigate public health effects. If necessary, thankfully, many of its provisions were not necessary, but the fact they were there was absolutely essential, and it gave reassurance, I think, to the whole process. We were able to offer further advice directly to the Minister, Graham Day, at that time, on specific matters such as there being no need for multiple days of poll. But I have to say, the cooperation with ministers, with all of the political parties, through at least three meetings with each party represented in the Parliament, and with government directly, was very valuable and a key element to the success of our preparation on the legislative side. Thank you, Chair. I hope that wasn't too long.
Not in the slightest. Thank you, Malcolm. And can I also thank you for putting on record, and I'm sure the committee here will echo that, our thanks to the local authorities and to all of the other almost unnoticed people that make the elections go ahead safely. Thank you for that. The questions come in sort of themed groups, just to make answering it easier. And I was going to kick off concentrating really on the voter experience. And I was just going to ask, I mean, clearly the election went ahead successfully under incredibly challenging circumstances. And I wondered whether any of the witnesses have comments in relation to the planning and the work that went on to make the polls safe for the individual voters who were attending. So I don't know whether you'd like to kick off with that, Malcolm, and expand on what you have commented on.
Yes, thank you, Chair, Convener. Happy to do that. One of our major concerns was that despite the work on the legalities and the planning and the, if you like, the policy framework for the election, that voters simply would be too nervous to come along, or they might take fright. And we put a great deal of effort into publicising how safe polling places and stations would be. And, you know, it's trite to say, well, at the time of voting, people were going out to supermarkets and to some people were at work, some people were on transport. So, you know, of course, a polling place is safe. But when people are doing something they haven't done for some time, they're nervous about doing that. So we were very conscious of that. And the planning, not to get into too much detail, but the appointment of the additional member of staff to intercept people at the door of the polling place to say, this is how it will be. This is what you have to do. This is why you have to do it. I think was absolutely essential, because it stopped people feeling I'm committing to this by going into the polling station itself, and then I can't get out of it even if I'm not comfortable. There was room for questions. There was room for reassurance about how safe the places were. And then, of course, when people came into the polling station, they saw the screens, they saw the distancing, they saw the single pencils, they saw the cleaning of the polling booths after use. And I think that was an essential part of it. It's not all about pre-publicity. There has to be somebody there on the day to explain what's going to happen and what's different. I've focused a bit there on the polling place itself, but part of that is the publicity, and part of that is the reassurance given, I have to say, by the political parties as well about the safety of the process. That support was critical.
Have you had any thoughts on those additional elements about what would be retained going forward? For example, the meet and greet, which certainly a number of people expressed their thanks to me that it was happening. They felt easier going in.
Well, Convener, that's interesting to hear, and that's good to hear. I would like, on a personal basis, I would certainly like, if funding permits, to retain the extra member of staff. I think next year's local government election is likely still to be conducted in a COVID-sensitive environment. There will still be questions. It's also, of course, a different means of voting. It's the only election in which there's STV. So the number of times you emphasise that, the better. In any case, to the voter. So I would like to keep that side of it. The screens and everything, we will take advice from Public Health Scotland, and we will see what's happening in other public environments. But certainly I would like to retain that possibility.
Excellent, thank you. Can I turn to you, Bob?
Thank you very much, Convener. And can I just echo the Convener's comments about the excellent work that went into planning these elections, making them safe and secure and credible. And for those who worked on the day, certainly in my constituency at the count, it was exceptional. So I don't know if that's the case for all members. It feels a little bit churlish now to scrutinise some of the aspects for how we could improve things further, but in that context, I just wanted to make sure that I'm a strong believer the elections went incredibly well in hugely challenging circumstances. So it seems churlish to ask about why we didn't do better in relation to postal votes. Now, I have to put on record that 24% of people applied for a postal vote. Previously, that was 18%. But previously indicated 38% of voters wished to apply and secure a postal vote, but that didn't turn out to be the case. I'm just wondering why there was that differential between those who indicated they wished a postal vote and those who actually took the steps to apply for it.
Would you like to take that, Andy?
I'll say a few things, and perhaps then my colleague Phil Thompson might want to add. I think what you say, Bob, is really interesting, but I think we have to remember that the research, which the figure you're quoting from is our research, which we did in August and November 2020, and then again in February, and it largely remained consistent in the sense of what it was saying. Yes, it was a snapshot, and people said up to 38%, 40% of ordinary voters might vote by post. But we always had a majority of people who wanted to vote by polling place, and that's why it was very important to have polling places which were safe and also postal voting. I refer to it in my introductory comments, the twists and turns of the pandemic. In the first instance, in August when we were doing the research, it was only to the latter end of it where there was a bit of an upsurge in the numbers. So you're getting snapshots of what people think at the time. I mean, I think you also have to remember that in the end, we put a lot of effort, and the Electoral Registration Officers did a lot of efforts to ensure that people were aware of the voting methods which were available, and particularly the write-out in February of 2021, when not only did they refresh and make more accurate the register, but made people aware of options to vote, proxy, postal voting, or in-station. You finished up with 24%. Now, that's a huge amount of voters, bearing in mind you were starting around about, Phil, correct me if I'm wrong, about 16.8 around the December. That's about 7% increase. In a normal election period, the electoral registration officers would expect to get a 1% increase. So that was a massive increase compared to normal. So at that, I'm going to stop and ask if Phil wants to add anything.
Phil.
Thanks, Andy. I think the only thing I would add is just in relation to the 38%. As Andy said, that came from some public opinion research that we did really to help inform planning for what might be needed at the polls. And when we published it, we were kind of clear that it was to be taken as an indicative number in the sense that it showed that there was very likely to be an increase in the people that wanted a postal vote, but that it wouldn't necessarily be 38% of people. And I think in particular, that's because in these types of surveys, we always see a degree of overclaim in relation to any kind of turnout. So if we ask people about whether they have voted even after the poll, we know that more people tell us they've voted than actually have voted from the figures that we have. And I think it's a very similar effect when we asked if they would like to vote by post or at a polling station. And we're seeing it. We saw then a degree of overclaim in the volume of people who were telling us, oh, they would definitely vote and they would like to do it by post. And as Andy said, that 24% that we saw in the end, I think, is possibly what we would have thought was a more realistic prospect, even from when we did the survey results.
Remember, in our post-poll survey, 94% of people who voted said they used the method of voting which they preferred to use. So, people change their opinions.
Yeah, that's very helpful. And I caveated the question on the basis about the significant increase that there was in reality, irrespective of what that snapshot opinion poll or the survey from the Electoral Commission showed. But can I just check whether or not anyone believes that bringing forward the deadline for applying for a postal vote may have curtailed slightly the amount of people who eventually did apply for a postal vote? And I'm minded that 4,000 postal vote applications were received after that earlier deadline. And I'm just wondering what work went on communicating with individual voters who applied for a postal vote after the deadline to remind them, for example, they could in theory have a proxy vote or other ways to make sure that their democratic mandate was exercised.
I mean, you're right, 4,072 applied post the 6th of April, which was the new deadline for postal voting. I mean, in a sense, there's always a deadline for everything. And 4,000, I am told by my electoral registration officer colleagues, is not a huge number. And I think it works out at 0.4% of all postal voters. So it is quite a small number. It was ultimately a decision for government. People gave advice. I think the reason, you have to remember the reason why the Scottish Government moved it forward, because the evidence, which you talked about before, was perhaps up to 40% postal votes. And the fear was a huge application, a number of applications at the very end of the deadline, which the electoral registration officers wouldn't be able to deal with, and therefore people wouldn't be able to get their chosen method of voting. I think it's really interesting that, because one of the things we talk about is barriers in the electoral process, and there is work being thought about and ongoing about online postal vote application, which is probably one of the last barriers to dealing with postal votes when people want them at short notice. It is quite a complicated process to deal with for the electoral registration officers. I think you have to remember as well, for the 4,000 who didn't get a postal vote, it's down to the individual EROs, but my understanding is EROs do contact people and tell them that they can, whilst they haven't got a postal vote, they can have a proxy vote. They would have 3 weeks from the 6th until the 27th to apply for the proxy vote. They also, of course, could still go to a polling place and vote. And not to be flippant about it, people weren't going on holiday, which is a very common reason for a postal vote. So, you weren't going anywhere. Although I accept that, obviously, people are applying for lots of reasons, some of which is concern around the public health situation. But we were also telling people at the time the messages that polling places were safe.
I'm just wondering whether, because I'm not sure we hear, except everything said, Mr. Neil, but I'm not quite sure we heard there about whether there was a consistent approach taken across Scotland in terms of contacting those who applied after the deadline for a postal vote. I'm not sure that's something Malcolm or Chris would be able to say more about.
I'll jump in. I think that, as Andy said, the general approach of the Electoral Registration Office in communicating with voters at any time is to emphasise where they stand in the process and what the options are. And we'd have to check with our ERO colleagues, but my understanding would be that that would be a consistent approach. They'd be told what their options are at that point.
OK, that's helpful. Getting that information back would be quite helpful, I think, to the committee. Now, of course, there was an increased provision for proxy voting in Scotland, particularly if someone had COVID symptoms or had coronavirus, for example. It's a good thing that wasn't particularly used. Now of course, that could have been because people weren't aware of it or because it wasn't required. I wonder if you could just say a little bit more, one of our witnesses say a little bit more about that. And in doing so, they may also want to refer to the suggestion that I certainly got on the doorstep that carers perhaps should be able to apply for emergency proxy votes, for example. I had constituents who didn't want to say they had coronavirus symptoms to get an emergency proxy because it simply wasn't true, but caring responsibilities prevented them from getting an emergency proxy. So a little bit more around that would be helpful.
Do you want to take that, Chris? Or
Will I start and then, yeah. I mean, the Commission has been calling for emergency proxies for carers for a number of years now, and many of the EROs agree with us. It particularly is prevalent, important in rural areas where, say on the islands, if you suddenly have to take someone to a hospital, they can get an emergency proxy, but you can't. So that is something specific which continues even beyond the pandemic. I mean, numbers of emergency proxies were higher than in 2016. We had 366 in 2016 and 1,310 last May. They were much lower than in the independence referendum in 2014, where we nearly got 7,000 emergency proxies. Some people, and Phil may want to comment on this, the proxy is, I think, not as well understood by the electorate as postal voting. It's limited the number of people, close family or up to two people you can be a proxy for. It's not as well known. It is advertised. We make it aware, people aware of it on our website. It's in our leaflets and such like. EROs do the same thing. But at the same time, there does seem to be a reluctance to use it.
Okay. Thank you. And just, I don't know if Phil's going to come in or not, but just I want to roll together a final question, which if we don't have time constraints, I'm happy to be written to in relation to it. So any more comments on emergency proxies would be helpful, but I had been talking about postal vote applications, and I'm just wondering whether data's held about who applied for those postal vote applications. There's data there on who were first-time applicants to apply for postal votes, but in terms of our black and minority ethnic communities, did they disproportionately more likely or less likely to apply for a postal vote? Those in low-income areas of multiple deprivation, were they more likely or less likely to apply for a postal vote? Because I'm conscious that there won't be a uniform uptake in application and casting of postal votes across Scotland, and there may be variations around that. And I would be quite keen to better understand that. I don't want to open up that as a wider conversation this morning, but if you have data on that, I think the committee would find it helpful.
Okay.
Some of that data would have to be looked at through post-election surveys. If it's protected characteristics that we're looking at for people, that doesn't apply in, that doesn't get shown in the applications that come through. But certainly we can look at where the applications came from at what time.
Okay, thank you. Can I just say then, if that's okay, I mean, obviously it's for the Electoral Management Board and the Electoral Commission to take its own view on whether that's a worthwhile exercise. But I know our convener's going to pursue turnout shortly. One of the ways to maximise turnout, as we know, is you're much more likely to cast a vote if you have a postal vote than if you turn up in person. So that is one way to make sure areas where there's particularly low-income households that are traditionally less likely to vote on many occasions, where we can maximise that turnout. So any data that can be provided would be welcome. Or if the data set doesn't exist, perhaps the Electoral Management Board or Electoral Commission could think about ways to create that data set. Thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you, Bob. And certainly it might be useful once you've had time to consider that, perhaps to write to the committee. And as Bob says, even if there are spaces, gaps in the information, that would be useful to know as well. If we just look at the turnout of the election, it was the highest of any Scottish Parliament election to date. What are the indicators about why that increase happened? Don't know. Malcolm.
If I could come in there, I would like to think it was on account of both the publicity about the election and the reassurance about not just its safety, but about how it would be conducted from everybody's perspective. I don't just mean the voter, I mean also the candidates and indeed the staff who were doing it. I come back to the preparation, and I come back to the preparation of all participants, all members of the electoral community in this. I think that reassurance and that publicity, once the decision was taken, this election will be going ahead unless it needed to be postponed for emergency reasons. We were then able to focus on how it would be different and how campaigning would be different. I think that, I'm sure for the political parties, that was a very difficult area. But I think there was reassurance that all aspects of this election had been covered, and in addition to the issues the issues on which people vote, I think that too contributed to the higher turnout. I also had a sense, and this is purely unscientific, that there was a wish to return to such normal aspects of civic life as people could, and that includes participation in the electoral process. That's not a scientific comment, however, but that was something we picked up just from speaking to returning officers.
Mm-hmm. Can I just drill into that slightly? Because there was increased advertising about the election coming forward, and you say that there was also a lot of advertising in relation to the instilling a confidence in the voter to come out. If I was to ask you which of those two made the difference, which would you go with? Was it the fact that the advertising was giving confidence to voters to come out, or was it just advertising that the election was happening? Or, and I think this may be the case, it's actually a combination of both of those?
I genuinely think it's the latter. COVID focused everybody's minds on how you undertake specific actions. Is it safe to do this? Is it safe to do that? Is it safe to do this to a certain extent or not at all? So the publicity was so total, and people were looking for that. They were, the publicity mentioned elections, so people started thinking more about elections, and then you get into how all this effort is being made, all this reassurance is given about how safe the process is. Well, perhaps that subconsciously increases the feeling that I might participate in it myself. I genuinely think it was a combination.
Thank you. Sorry, Andy, did you want to come back?
Yeah, I mean, I think it would be nice to see that electoral administration got 63.5% of people to go and vote, and in the independence referendum, 84% or whatever it was. I don't think electoral administrators can claim that, and I don't think the Electoral Commission can claim that, sadly. I think it's down to you guys and the issues and the debates. What we're about is making sure that barriers in the process aren't in place to stop people registering, stop people applying for postal votings. It should be easy, accessible, easy to understand. And, you know, how to complete their ballot papers easily, efficiently, and reflect their particular views. And we all did that in sense of lots and lots of publicity, which Malcolm talked about, in terms of supplying stuff to partner organisations who used it from the autumn of 2020 onwards. And, you know, our leaflet to households and all the stuff which you know we do. But in the end of the day, I think people are motivated by the politicians and the issues and the desire to express their views rather than that. And, I mean, I don't know if Phil wants to add anything from the kind of post-opinion research we've got.
Maybe just before you do that, Phil, can I invite Edward, who I think has a... No, my apologies, he's withdrawn his question. Did you want to add anything to that, Phil?
Just to support really what Andy said, I mean, our post-poll public opinion research very much supports the idea that people are voting, you know, because they think it's important, because they think it's their civic duty, and also because they simply want to have a say. And in fact, the reasons that we saw people give this year for voting were very, very consistent with reasons we would have seen in, say, 2016, after the last Scottish Parliament election. So I think it's all about the sort of maybe additional focus on politics, politicians potentially, from seeing people maybe on TV every day talking about coronavirus. But there'll be lots and lots of different factors that are at play. One maybe slightly more administrative point might be that with more people taking up postal voting, we do know that postal voters are more likely to actually vote once they've got a postal vote. So 87% of people who are issued with a postal vote return the postal vote. So I suppose that increase in postal voters may have played a little bit of a part in driving up the overall level of turnout at the poll.
Thank you. And I suppose pursuing that slightly, there was, I think criticism is too strong, there was a view from was it two-thirds of voters, that the actual process of voting took longer. And we've obviously heard already about the measures that were put in place, the one-way systems, the meet and greet, the single pencils. But I wondered what other options were considered but then discounted to make the polling station itself safe. I don't know who would like. Malcolm, would you like to start with that?
The most significant one, convener, was the limitation on the numbers attending. I mean, we were very, you can't stipulate how voters turn out. Of course, they can all turn out in the evening, they can all turn out in the morning, and indeed weather was quite a factor in central Scotland on polling day, resulting in a large number or a disproportionately large number of voters appearing in the evening in many localities. But that showed, I think, the wisdom of limiting strictly, and it was stricter than many would have liked, I think, the number of voters per station, and to at least attempt to regulate the numbers coming through so that queues didn't form too much, and that there was simply time for everybody to vote. That was the most significant element of preparation there.
Were there any ideas that were considered but then discounted? I mean, I know there was the ability to hold the election over a few days, which you've explained.
Yes.
But was there anything else?
Yeah. The multiple days was certainly the default option there, I think, if the process had to be so slowed down as to be almost individual, just the voter and the polling staff in the station at one time, then I think we would have had to move to that option.
I'm grateful.
But it's like all elections, it's a combination of speed, it's a combination of getting voters through, of counting ballot papers in a way that's efficient and quick and produces a result, with obviously with on this occasion the heightened requirements for safety.
Thank you. Alexander, can I pass over to you?
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. Can I also echo your comments and others, convener, about how impressed I was, and I think it was very hard for you not to be impressed by the dedication that was put into ensuring that these elections took place, and I commend and congratulate all who supported that. Can I look at specific areas for my questioning? This was the first time that a Scottish Parliament election had qualifying foreign nationals and also prisoners serving 12 months or less allowed to vote. So can I ask about the qualifying foreign nationals first? How many did we have who were registered to vote? And looking on your reflections as to how that was managed to promote and ensure, you've talked about already this morning about barriers and accessibility and trying to remove these barriers. So can I ask about what your reflections are on how foreign nationals participated within the election and what lessons, if anything, you've learned from that?
Can I ask Phil to talk about the numbers and then I can talk about the barriers?
Please do. Phil?
Yeah, no problem, Andy. One challenge that we have around knowing how many new foreign nationals were registered is that effectively they appear on the electoral registers in the same way as existing EU citizens who were obviously already registered. So it wasn't possible to count very easily kind of the additional foreign nationals that were registered. But we know from looking at previous figures and then figures for the sort of total number of foreign nationals on the register now that there was an increase, and it looks like an increase of around 26,000 or so between the last time we had the figures and now. Obviously that may be slightly offset by the fact that some EU citizens may also have left Scotland since that previous count. So it's difficult to be precise, but it does look like there was a reasonably substantial increase in numbers registered.
Excellent. And then maybe the barriers and how accessible you found it to manage, Andy.
Yeah, I mean, in terms of barriers, we'd a lot of obviously general publicity work, which you know about. But we also, we find it's much more effective to work via our partners and delivering tools, political literacy information, all that sort of stuff, and then they share it with their members. So we worked from the autumn of last year with various partners. We worked with a network of the consulates in Scotland to ensure that they, their nationals knew information that they could now vote in Scottish Parliament elections. We worked with the regional quality councils. We worked with organisations such as the Scottish Refugee Council, COSLA, and the Local Authority Resettlement Officers Network, who deal directly with people who are new Scots in that sense. The resources resulted in an uptake. We did 19 sessions with the Scottish Refugee Council to ensure that the people who work for them could then relate to others. Obviously, we could do more. You can always do more. And I think one of the lessons we've got, and one of our emphases is going forward to 2022 and beyond, is to ensure that we're developing much more capacity to deliver political literacy via networks.
Yeah. And the second question was about the prisoners serving 12 months or less. What kind of statistic and data do we have with reference to that sector as to how many were registered and how many participated, and what barriers once again you had to try and manage that process, because this was once again a new dimension to the whole process, and taking on board and what lessons once again have we learnt from that exercise in ensuring that we can see how that was progressed.
Yeah, I mean, yes, prisoners, a new thing, 12 months or less. We do know that there was 38 prisoners registered at the election. I think for us, it was definitely about trying to put in place processes so prisoners could be informed of their right to register if they were eligible, and then to be able to vote. So when the 2020 Act came in, we worked with EROs to develop vote application forms specifically for prisoners and forms so they could apply for postal votes. We worked with Scottish Government colleagues and Scottish Prison Service colleagues, and the Electoral Registration Officer specifically worked locally with various prisons to ensure that all of this information was distributed. Also provided voter information for Scottish Prison Service on how to vote, how to fill in ballot papers. We worked with Citizen Advice Scotland to ensure that their workers who work with prisoners understood political literacy. 38 isn't a great number, no. I'd accept that. But again, this is new. We're getting into this. We're hoping to work with the Scottish Prison Service, Education Service, henceforward going towards the council elections next May.
Okay. And my final question, convener, is about those who had disabilities or long-term health conditions. Within some of the report, there was a slight dissatisfaction from that sector as to how they found it a bit more challenging. For example, when they were identifying chosen candidates or parties on the regional ballot paper, that they found that, the ballot paper itself was extensive, I think it's the best way to describe it, and that was much more of a challenge for individuals who fall into these categories and how they were supported to manage that. So once again, how are you looking into some of that to reflect on where you can and what can be done in future? Because I don't see that changing dramatically over the next election or even further on. So there needs to be some support mechanism in there to try and identify and support individuals who have that disability or that long-term illness.
Yeah, certainly. The support of voters with disabilities is a huge part of the work that electoral administrators take on when they deliver elections. And as Andy said, our aim is to make sure that every voter has got the opportunity to participate in the election. Minimise many barriers that exist. All polling staff are trained to support voters with disabilities. This year, as obvious in these discussions, we were dealing with an election delivered under very unique circumstances, and it did mean that there was quite a turnover of staff. So potentially in some places, some of the more experienced staff might not have been on duty as they would normally have been. However, everyone was trained. We certainly made sure that there were videos available to explain how to deal potentially with voters with sight loss or visual impairment in particular. That is always an issue. For voters with sight loss and visual impairment, it's very important that we do all we can to make sure they can vote secretly and independently. And we're continuing our work with disability organisations and the Disability Network. We've got a meeting this afternoon, in fact, with RNIB Scotland and Sight Scotland to talk about how we can improve these methods in the future. And there's a work stream that we're involved in at the moment with Scottish Government looking at new ways to increase the accessibility of elections, potentially with new devices that can be used in polling places. Ultimately, though, it's about the interaction between the polling staff and the voter. The voter needs to be able to trust when they come in they're going to be supported and be able to vote in a way that they feel easiest and comfortable with. They can get someone to help them, they can bring a companion in to help them, or there are devices, tactile voting devices, that they can be used. Our challenge is to make sure that our staff have got the skills and the understanding of how to do that. We've got material for that. The Commission support us in training material to allow us to do that. And we're satisfied that we did it as well as we could, but there are ways to improve. And as I said, we're continuing to do that, and we've got meetings even this afternoon.
And the ballot paper, as I say, was one of the biggest barriers, it would appear, just because of the size and the length of that. Are there any reflections on what can be looked at for that in the future?
The ballot paper is a defined document in law, so there's little that we can do in the confines of the legislation to change the ballot paper. And in some ways, it's a reflection on the success of the democratic process that it was long. I mean, we attracted an awful lot of parties to stand on the regional lists. And unfortunately, that becomes unwieldy when it gets that big. However, the design, the colour, the font, they can all be looked at to make sure it is still something that can be understood and well handled. But while we're dealing with paper and there's an ability for as many people to stand as they can, the length of that will be something we'll just have to deal with.
It is fair to say that people with disabilities found it slightly harder than people who weren't disabled to fill in the ballot paper. And I think, as Chris says, that there was... I think ORUs in general accept that because of the context of the pandemic, the training context of being online, the loss of lots of key presiding officers and the lowering of experience. We do, and you've seen our report, that the disability representative bodies are reporting back that people didn't have a great time in certain instances. And I think that's something we've got to take forward and improve on for next May. I think there's also work elsewhere being undertaken about alternatives to try and help people with disabilities to fill in ballot papers, some kind of, you know, readers and things like this, which can come, because they help the situation. But in the end of the day, for the vast majority of people, it's about people in polling places, good training, giving good assistance. So hopefully by next May we'll get back on track.
Okay, thank you very much, Convener.
Thank you, Alexander. Just to pursue that, though, disabled organisations have said for a while, over a number of elections, that the experience that disabled people have is less favourable than others. If I was to put you on the spot, will that change in May, or will this be a longer journey? And what assistance do you need to shorten the journey so that their experience is the same or indeed better than others?
I think it probably is a longer journey, but I also think it will improve next May at the council elections, because I think I've known the return officers as a body for a long, long time. I think some of them are very disappointed in their own efforts. So that, in terms of an emphasis on training, we're going to work with the MB to ensure that the facilities which ROs need, the training the tools, will be used. There'll be great emphasis given by the convener on disability issues. But I think the longer term, and I know Scottish Government and Cabinet Office are looking at technology to solve issues around making voting easier for people with disabilities, but that is, I suspect, very unlikely to come in for next May.
So as you said, it's indeed that relationship that happens when they walk into the polling station. Excellent. Edward, can I come to you, please?
Thank you, Convener. My question is really around campaigning. This election obviously was extremely different to any other election that I'd taken part in. You know, I won't go back to the one in 1979, which was my first, but do you think the rules regarding campaign activity were clear enough for both candidates and campaigners?
Sorry, who would like to take that? Malcolm?
Thank you, Convener. Can I just add in relation to the last item, the experience for disabled voters will form a particular element of the joint training session, the joint support session, which the Commission and the EMB jointly organises in each January or February before an election, and we will pick up on all of these specific points.
To return to
the question, I think the guidance was well received. I think political parties did very well. It's not really for me to comment on that, but I think the high percentage of voters who felt communicated with, if I can put it that way, by political parties is very commendable given the circumstances. But I think there needed to be guidance. I think it was well received, and certainly from a neutral perspective, it seemed proportionate to us in any case.
Thank you, Malcolm.
Can I come back on that, Convener? Because I think the issue is, you know, having been on the doorsteps, it was very, very much a fact of just delivering leaflets. We were not encouraged as candidates to engage with people on doorsteps till the very last part of the campaign, when a lot of the postal votes had already gone out. And there were certainly no public meetings and no hustings, which I think as a candidate is difficult. But I can take it back to the next level, is if we're going to be restricted as candidates, and I understand the reasons why, do you think that we ought to consider whether there should be an increased budget for candidates to get their message out? For example, the budget for a candidate in a constituency has remained the same in 2021, 2016, went up in 2011, but the constituency limit for party spending has remained the same since 2011. The figures very little. If we're going to be restricted as candidates from getting our message out on doorsteps, surely we should have the increased ability to use media and postal systems to get our message out, because that probably was the safest way. I wondered if you'd like to comment on that.
Thank you, Edward. Andy, would you like to comment?
I'll make a brief comment and then bring Louise Edwards in, who may want to say something. I mean, I think Mr. Mountain's quite right. The public health rules around the election meant you couldn't leaflet until the 15th of March. You couldn't canvass until the 12th of April. And in our post-opinion research with the candidates, we did get the view back that they felt restricted in what they could do and what they couldn't do. The other side of that, of course, is the voter, who your customers, as it were, felt that they did have enough information to make choices. 76% of them thought that they had enough information. So it's swings and roundabouts. One hopes in next May we won't have pandemic restrictions, but who knows? And at that, I'm going to be quiet and ask Louise if she wants to add anything.
Louise, and welcome, Louise.
Thank you. I'm sorry, Andy, you cut out a little bit for me there, so I apologise to the panel if I am, to the committee, if I'm repeating things that you've already said. But yes, I mean, a very, very fundamental point about campaigning. Campaigning is such an essential part of democracy. You really cannot have an election without people who are willing to campaign in it and people who are willing to put themselves forwards as candidates. And in this very unique situation of the public health backdrop, yes, there were restrictions in place on campaigning in this particular election, which, you know, you would hope would not actually be there in any future elections. One of the keys, and I think this has come through in some of our post-poll research, though, is to ensure that there are a variety of ways that candidates and other campaigners can communicate with voters. So if, for example, for a public health reason, one route is restricted, there are other routes that people can take, you know, so yes, being able to go and canvass, yes, being able to drop leaflets, to have hustings, to use digital online campaigning as well, which we know did increase as it has been for many elections, but still does not remain the number one way that people want to communicate with voting. Actually, overwhelmingly, you know, people, candidates in Scotland at this election wanted to communicate in person. And actually, that's a significant trend that we see, even if digital campaigning is getting bigger. Thinking about the spending limit point in particular, though, I think there'd be a little bit of research and looking at the data that would have to be done to see whether or not that upper limit is being reached before deciding whether or not to go beyond it. And one of the real key issues for me is there has to be a sort of a level playing field for independent candidates or for those that are not supported by, for example, a party machinery or a big party machinery. Because one of the things that having a spending limit does is make sure that people who don't have large financial resources behind them can still afford to consider putting themselves forward and then ultimately perhaps become an independent candidate or a candidate for a smaller party. So there's a lot of factors to think about when you're thinking about the spending limit for campaigning. But really crucially for me, and I think it comes through that this did happen on this occasion, is any restriction that's in place clearly needs to be proportionate and for a very good reason, like say a public health issue. But also has to allow broad participation in campaigning. It has to allow people to still be able to communicate with voters.
Thank you. Is that investigation into the spend and how parties stroke individuals approached it taking place? Is it intended to take place? Because it certainly would seem to be a prerequisite to this discussion that Edward has raised about considering raising it. Would that be possible?
It is something that we have looked at doing on a UK level, and within that we would want to be able to break it down by parts. So I'm not going to sit here and tell you I can have it with you next week, but it is something that we are looking at. And as when we get to the point where we've got something sensible to share, I'm sure we can do that.
Edward.
Sorry, Convener, just very briefly, if the spending limits were correct and proportionate before the rules and regulations changed, surely if the rules and regulations change about canvassing and campaigning, then those limits need to be reviewed. It's as simple as that. They can't be right in a pandemic and right out with a pandemic. Just an observation, Convener.
Thank you for putting that on record. Paul, could I turn to you?
Yeah, thank you, Convener. And it's really just expanding on the point that Edward's made, because I think part of the study after the election was that 43% of candidates felt they got their message across, but the same amount disagreed. And in that regard, 86 said that their opportunities for face-to-face campaigning, quite rightly, was reduced, was affected a lot in the campaigning. And I suppose it's maybe getting back to the point around about the financing, the limits that are there. And I suppose we have the next election coming up in May, and I suppose it's kind of expanding on that. Is there further consultation, for example? Louise, you mentioned obviously around about the work around about looking at, looking a bit more and deeper look into it. But is there an opportunity for consultation with the political party, Scottish Government themselves in that regard? And what kind of timescales would we be talking about? Because obviously you have long campaign, short campaign. Looking back now from May, when would that have to be in place if we're talking about getting new limits out, if that was the case? And I think we've already mentioned, I think, Andy, you've talked about it's likely to take part in a COVID-restricted way anyway. It might not be as severe as we were last May, but it could still be a COVID-type election. So it's trying to get maybe down to around about what the timescales would be in that regard, if we needed to look at that, as Edward's mentioned, a bit of review. And even if that was just a one-off, and then review it after that, depending on the situation about public health and so on. So it's maybe a little bit deeper dive into some of the answers.
Louise, would you like to take that on the time limits?
Yep, absolutely happy to. I mean, the limits are actually set out in statute, so it would depend on whether or not that was a priority matter for the government to look at. And then you'd have to sort of work back from there as to when the government decided to consult or gather evidence from us or other bodies in order to inform that. But our sort of general principle in these situations is that if you're going to make any changes to the campaign finance rules, they really should be done a minimum of 6 months before those rules kick in. Okay. So if you're looking about a spending limit only over any kind of regulated period, long, short, party, whatever it is, we would want the changes to be in place 6 months before that period began.
Right. So not quite a lot of time.
That's okay. For the Scottish Parliament, of course, the next one is 2026. We've still got quite a long way away, because a long period only takes place at at a general election at the Scottish Parliament, and the by-election limits are set in statute anyway, so you would have to change them. But you do have time to think about it.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you for that. And I think you know the question around about the restrictions that candidates felt, I think, was kind of answered in the previous question. Can I move on to digital imprints? This was obviously the first time they were brought forward, the first time they were required. Can you tell us about the compliance with the new rules and whether there were it was felt it was beneficial to voters or not? And maybe, Andy, the first question to yourself, but and I think the second thing probably to Phil would always be around about, were they beneficial? What evidence have we looked at in that regard? And was there any feedback on that, particularly from voters in that regard?
Yeah. I'm going to actually pass the question to Louise, who will answer that.
Happy to answer. Okay, so the first thing I would say is a digital imprint have two real fundamental purposes. One is that a voter looking at a particular piece of material online can see who's given it to them, can make a choice about whether to let it influence their vote. And another really important purpose is that it helps us as regulator to track spending and make sure that campaigners, candidates and parties are complying with the campaign finance rules. What we saw in Scotland, obviously this was a new law and one that we think is very important to the system and important to resolving known concerns amongst voters about digital campaigning and its transparency, was that the majority of those who campaigned in the election did comply, wanted to comply. In fact, many parties, candidates, campaigners already put digital imprints on their material even before it was a legal requirement. So with a highly compliant campaigner community, we can be confident that voters would have seen a difference in the material that they saw online. Now, it is a little bit too early to say what impact that has had, primarily because it is simply one election and we want to let it bed in a little bit longer, but also because all the spending data has not yet come in from parties because the deadlines for it hasn't yet passed. So we're not in a position to kind of look at how it worked in terms of the transparency angle yet. Our experience during the campaign was hugely positive, of working with campaigners who, if they didn't have an imprint on their material, it was usually simply because they weren't aware and they moved quickly to comply when we told them what the rules were about. There is just one thing I would say, though, that one of the real difficulties is if there's no imprint on, it's very difficult to find out who should have put an imprint on. The imprint is the way that you find out whose material it is. So without an imprint, difficult to find out whose material it is. And that's not unique to digital imprints. That's an issue with print imprints as well. But one area that the government may want to think about is enabling us to get information out of social media companies, sort of for who's behind accounts, for who's behind the material, in order to help us try and find out who it is and bring them into compliance.
Thanks for that. My last question.
Sorry, Paul. Did you have many examples of that from the last election, or are you aware of any examples of that from the last election where you were unable to trace the where the slogan, picture, whatever had come from?
There were a couple of small examples that are still being looked at, so I won't go into details if you'll forgive me. But we've got a very good relationship with the social media companies and we can speak to them and we can work on that slightly more informal basis with them to try and find out who are behind platforms. But really, without a sort of clear power to be able to get information from them, we are hindered.
But it is a challenge that occurs in other jurisdictions that require imprints. Thank you. Sorry, Paul.
No, thanks, Camina. Last question, really, just talking about the administrative challenges, I suppose, and we've heard the great job that the administrators have done in extremely difficult circumstances. I wonder if there's been any feedback from probably the IROs or primarily in the roundabout, any difficulties that they faced and any additional support they felt would have been provided. And I suppose one other question as well, and you know, as part of the report, it mentioned around about three quarters of returning officers mentioned about difficulty in recruiting polling station staff. Now, that might have just been a one-off in regards to the situation around about COVID. Has that been a difficulty before, and do we see that as a difficulty going forward? I don't know who would be best, Andy, if that would be yourself or
Christian.
Malcolm or myself.
Malcolm, if we come to you first.
To lead off. Thank you, convener. I'm sure Chris will be able to contribute some detail to There were particular difficulties with the last election, I would say, obviously on account of staff nervousness. But we did not at the end of the day have difficulties. We had contingency plans for support from other sectors as well. But it is undoubtedly useful to be able to work with staff that you know and have some experience of. I think the ageing workforce in the public sector is inevitably going to be of which I am part, is inevitably going to be a factor. But we have used, and I think this is an important point, the third officer, the information officer, or whom we used in this election, they were invariably, certainly in many areas, younger people who I certainly took some time to encourage in the process and seemed encouraged by the process and interested in it. So I'm hoping very much that many of them will become the polling clerks and then POs of the future, because we need to, it's succession planning as best we can. But as I say, the age profile of the public sector is not helpful in that regard. But the process itself is of interest to many people, and once they realise it's not it's meeting people, it's not just an administrative process, it's actually there's a public relations element to it, there's a social element to it. Often people come back once they've tried it for the first time. It's getting people into the electoral process for the first time that can be difficult. But that's undoubtedly is something we have to keep a very close eye on.
Thank you, Chris. Would you?
I think Malcolm's right. In our own review of the conduct and the delivery of this election, one of the feedback elements we had from return officers right across Scotland was that there was quite a significant difficulty in recruiting and retaining staff. There were some late call-offs of staff, which meant we were having to replace staff. All staff need to be trained, and it's important to make sure that they understand the job, because, as Malcolm was saying, it is very much a face-to-face social job. The delivery of elections in Scotland is a sort of peer-to-peer process where citizens are helping each other to vote. It's not really a case of us engaging with the state. It's helping each other to run democracy. So it's important that the people that are doing that understand the process, but also it's a customer-facing role. So certainly one of our learning points from this going forward is that we need to look at what that pool of staff is and make sure we've got a good, growing, reliable and robust pool of staff that we can draw on in future and explain what that job is, so that people can, as we say, help each other deliver democracy.
Thank you. Andy, you had a comment?
If I could just add a comment about the elector registration officers and talking about resources and such like, because our research indicated that there was a large pool of people who wanted to do postal voting and use other options rather than polling places. And Scottish Government funded, on request, the AROs to provide extra staff so they could deal with the massive increase in postal vote applications. And they did things like, apart from just the staff to do the work, they did a TV advert across Scotland to encourage people to understand the options for voting. They used the PR tools which we provided with them last autumn. But they also did the write out to the household for the household notification. And that is really, we think that's really important, because not only does it tell people about the options for voting, but it also refreshes the register before an electoral event, which is a very good thing. It's done quite a lot in England. And we recommend in the report that that should be looked at for being continued and being funded.
Chair, can I just ask a supplementary? It's probably coming back to recruitment of polling station staff. And the training, does that tend to be local authority by local authority? And I know, for example, when it comes down to local authority, I'm in, because it's talking around about it maybe get 2 or 3 months before the election and they'll try and bring people forward kind of stuff. Is it an ongoing basis? Is that something that it's left to local authority, or is that something that you monitor? And that's maybe coming back to this year end about recruitment, because if we can try and encourage people earlier into the process, because it might be that they're not aware of what the process is, what they need to do, and so on.
I'll let Chris answer, but there's a consistency provided by us, because we provide training materials and then it's over to the ROs.
It is the responsibility of each returning officer to recruit, train, employ the staff that will be delivering the election in the polling places. So each of the 32 returning officers has got that responsibility. However, as Andy said, there is a consistent set of training material that's made available by the Electoral Commission. This year in particular, the challenge was delivering that predominantly over Teams or Zoom or other ways that it was done online. Normally we make sure it's a face-to-face training session, but this time, again, and that worked very successfully, but it was a different challenge.
Thank you.
Thank you, nice Bob.
Yes. I'm just wondering, elections are now, of course, you're more often likely to be here with election on than not having election on. It's a kind of everyday business for local authorities, and returning officers are effectively the chief executives of local authorities almost by default. I have looked at this in another committee and another incarnation in relation to the role of chief executives as returning officers and the like. I'm not going down that road, but one of the things that came out of that inquiry in another committee was some local authorities have standing election offices that just do the work day to day, day in, day out, week in, week out, irrespective of whether there's an election scheduled, and other local authorities don't have that capacity or resource to do that. I don't know if they clustered together to run an elections office across local authority boundaries or what have you, but I suppose the reason I'm putting that on the record, convener, is resourcing is an issue. Capacity and time are vital. Forward planning is vital. What is the picture across Scotland's local authorities in terms of having standing elections offices who are looking forward not just 1 year but 2 years, 3 years, 5 years on a day-to-day basis, for example, not just think about writing out in a February before a May poll to give a uptake of postal vote applications, but also thinking more generally what their strategies are for the longer term, because that would surely help the organisation in the smooth running of elections.
Malcolm leads on elections in amongst the chief executives in Scotland, so he's probably best placed to answer.
Malcolm.
Thank you, convener. The question's an important one because undoubtedly both the volume and the complexity of the elections has increased in recent years. That's absolutely correct. And there will be no local authority in Scotland which does not have dedicated staff at middle and senior management with responsibility for elections. Well, they might not have a standing election office all the time, but it is now part of the permanent workload, let's say, of more than one member of staff. And much of that is indeed the communication, the keeping the processes under review, supporting the voter throughout the fallow periods as well as the election period. We do come together from time to time. Obviously, there are regional. The Scottish Parliament election always brings us together at regional level for obvious reasons. But I see it as a key role of the EMB it's not just to share good practice. It's much more than that. It's about keeping a supportive eye, as it were, on the electoral process and critically the capacity of returning officers and electoral registration officers to support the process when that's required. That's a supportive function, but it is also an interventionist function when we are able to provide when we're able to bring the expertise of others to support those who may just have lost key members of staff. We do some of that under the radar, and that's an important role of the board, I think.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Bob. Just to, I suppose, follow on with that, Malcolm, without naming names, are you confident about the capacity across Scotland at the moment? If it was a red, amber, green, where would you be on it?
Electoral administrator capacity, I think, is always an amber across Scotland. I mean, it is. There are many experienced practitioners who have served as returning officers, as deputies, as EROs for many years. And when they go, there is the usual. It's not that the job will not be done; it's the added value of that experience common to all sectors. So we do keep that constantly under review, and we do. working with electoral commission colleagues, you know, flag up any areas where we think additional support would be welcomed. And it always has been. That there is no question of imposition, of pushing ourselves in where we're not wanted. The support is always welcomed and appreciated.
Right, thank you.
But it is, I think it is a function of the EMB, which is not, strictly speaking, it's not a specific function, but if it wasn't there, if we weren't doing it, there would be a gap. I would go that far.
Thank you, Malcolm. Alexander.
I'd like to comment on our last question, if that's please possible, Convener. The importance, I think, we all understand about observing account is very important. And there was some criticism within the report about how administrators and candidates and agents themselves felt that there were, due to the restrictions, that was a barrier. And I know from my own count and others I spoke to that they did feel that there were some difficulties with that. What are we putting in place if there are still restrictions for the council elections that will be in a few months' time?
Stuart, I think the pandemic led to not as many as normal counting agents being available in the building because of public health rules, essentially. And that wasn't well received in certain places, and it was more received, and you know, people took the view that it's a pandemic, this is the sort of thing which happens and you have to put up with it. I think we all hope in the electoral community that next year it won't be the situation, but we're working with the EMB to try and come up with a process and a formula so we can ensure transparency in the count centre for the council elections, because remember the council elections are also e-counted, so there is limited availability in terms of what you can see. I mean, I think the orientation tables are a great opportunity personally to see stuff, but also you get the added benefits of all the reports afterwards, which political parties and anoraks love. But yeah, you're quite right, though it wasn't great, but you know, the circumstances led it to that. Exactly. But there are plans to try and ensure that it gets better and back to normal.
Thank you, Convener.
Edward, I was going to invite you in to ask a very similar question, but do you have a follow-on question?
I do, Convener. My question relates specifically, if I can put it into context, in the Highlands. And we've heard the reason that it was a great election, that lots of people stood. 16 parties stood on the regional list. And when it came to the count, we were all allowed 4 people to hover around very few counting stations, and we couldn't go from one region to another, which effectively rendered watching the count impossible. And I have no absolute confidence in the staff doing an excellent job, but I have no way of proving it. Do you think that's satisfactory? And do you think where there are big regional lists, the view on how to count them and how the count can be watched would be taken slightly differently to the way the Highland Council did?
Thank you, Edward. Who would like to say it?
I mean,
Andy.
Malcolm, I think it's
Malcolm. Sorry.
No, my apologies. I came in before I was asked.
From the Commission's perspective, I don't have the exact details before me as the arrangements for the Highland Count, although it was over 2 sites. Or 3 sites, technically. Transparency in the count is really, really important. We all accept that. And I think we all accept that. That wasn't... because of the pandemic, it wasn't as transparent as it should have been. There were observers there, and beyond the count, there were observers in the Highland Count Centre, I know for certain. I think it was a particular time and place, and we need to improve it, and I think we've got plans to make sure that it is improved for next time and going forward.
Malcolm.
Yes, Convener, I don't have much to add to that, except the EMB has conducted, along with the Commission, an in-depth reflection from each returning officer as to what as to particular issues. A lot of this, of course, is locality-based. I'm not speaking about Highland here. Much depends in a pandemic on practicalities like the size of the hall, how many people can safely be there. I would say, though, much guidance was given to returning officers within these practicalities to make different arrangements, for example, holding up the bundles of 50 or whatever votes for a quick run through so that agents could see that all the crosses were in the one one line, as it were, even recognising that each individual paper could not be scrutinised. But we have to remember the rules of the count. The agents are there to ensure that the process is being done correctly, that there is adequate scrutiny, not that every ballot paper is seen. But like Andy, I would acknowledge it was perhaps the least. It was the most difficult aspect of the process for returning officers, whose wish, of course, is to ensure as much transparency as possible. There also has to be a balance between speed and the level of transparency that would be there in a non-COVID environment. What I mean by that is, Every ballot paper could have been passed under a camera for agents to see, but the length of the count already over the 2 days would have been excessive in my view. Yeah. So there was a balance, and inevitably that balance does not satisfy all.
I mean, in essence, in May last, the counting agents really had to collectively ensure the acceptance of the process and accept the transparency, which effectively meant you couldn't, as the SNP or the Conservative Party or whatever, do your tallying as you would normally do for your own particular parties. Although there are in some places where they share tallies, certainly in Southern Ireland they do it, but it was also, it wasn't unknown this was going to occur. I mean, I know it caused upset in certain areas and it was perfectly acceptable, but via the political parties panel, all the parties in the Scottish Parliament knew it was going to happen, and it was just part of the consequences of the pandemic. But that said, that was then, and next May, hopefully, we can get back to a much fuller transparency so people can feel much more confident.
Please, Chris.
I'd also know that some that we've mentioned today are also legacy issues, things that we learned from this election that will be applied in future elections. And some of the technology and the methods that were used to increase transparency, given the limited number of people in a room and the physical distancing, we're going to try and apply in future elections. One of the issues there, of course, is about holding up doubtful ballot papers so that people can see the decision that's being taken on a doubtful ballot paper. Lots of return officers used sort of large projectors so that the ballot paper could be seen on a large projector screen. I think that was well received, and the idea is that will be used in future elections, even if that's not necessary because of physical distancing or the limited number of people in a count.
Bob, do you have a comment?
Thank you. Just very briefly on the doubtful or spoiled ballot papers. The Glasgow experience, which I have no issue with, I should point out before I say this, was that candidates and agents didn't get to see them all. They got to see a sample of ballot papers to show the type of decisions that were being made by staff there, which was fine. I'm just wondering, was that a standard thing across the country, or does each returning officer take a very different view in relation to that? Is there a standardised look at reviewing those papers?
Malcolm, would you like to comment?
I'll come in. Malcolm. I don't know if you heard the question, but certainly a number of surprised faces around this table. I wonder whether you want to take that away and perhaps write back.
Why don't I?
Yes, I'm happy to do that,
Mr. Burr. Why don't I drop you an email out with the meeting just to clarify the point I was making, just so that it's not misinterpreted or I've not articulated it properly. We can take that forward in that respect.
Thank you.
That would be very helpful. Thank you.
Excellent. Sorry, Edward. Is there anything you would like to follow up on?
Just a final question, Convener, that I have is overnight counting. Obviously, was not the norm as it has been in the past. Is that a good thing? Are there lessons to be learned from that regarding staffing and perhaps speeding up the results getting out, rather than waiting for ballot boxes to be delivered on slippery roads in May across Scotland? I mean, should we be doing overnight counting, or should we just be delaying it till the next day, make it easier, safer for staff and safer for people counting?
Who would like to take that?
It's been, thank you, convener. It's been very interesting to see the reaction of candidates and agents to the next day count, which has been generally very positive, and I think that does tell us something. I mean, it is, just as a matter of logic, unusual to be starting an important event at midnight when everyone has had a full day. I acknowledge, of course, the atmosphere and the enjoyment for many of the overnight count, but there was very limited negative reaction of which we're aware, and obviously that was partly due to the COVID circumstances of the count being over the next day. I have a personal view, and it's wholly personal, that it is unreasonable to commence overnight counts where there is no reasonable prospect of them finishing within a few hours, by which I mean by 4 or 5 in the morning. I think if a returning officer is having to think about changes of staff, about halting the count in the very in say 6 or 7 in the morning, then I think that is inefficient. I think that is going too far. I think it is putting too much strain on people. If your circumstances are such and smaller constituency, single constituency returning officers may wish, you know, can still do this. If you can finish it quickly, that there's an argument for doing it. But I think if it's going on beyond the early hours, then we should really be reflecting on whether that's optimum for anyone, not least the process itself. So we're taking that feedback and looking at it. But it was very instructive to see that there was not a huge negative reaction to the next day count.
Thank you, Malcolm. Would anyone else like to comment on that? Yes, Chris.
It's also worth noting that local government elections in Scotland are generally held. The count is the following day. And again, there are reasons for that in terms of the technology involved and the resilience of the structure, the services is much more enhanced when we've got the people on call and everyone's awake and able to operate.
Thank you. Edward, do you want to come back, or are you happy with...
No, convener. I think that if it's planned for, all I would say, if it's planned for the next day, it allows everyone to get their ducks in a row so it can happen quickly, rather than sometimes if it's done overnight, I've known it in Highland, late till 11 o'clock the next morning, and that just is dangerous in my mind for people who want to get home after what has been nearly 36 hours anyway, up and about.
Lovely. Thank you, Edward. Well, with that, can I thank all of the witnesses who've attended today, both in person and online. Thank you for your evidence. And at that point, as the next matter is to be taken in private, I will call an end to the public element of this meeting.